Good morning and welcome to another session on corporate governance. Today I will be discussing with you on a very interesting topic, especially the shareholders, about investors, and it is quite interesting to know, note down and understand. Moreover, it is good to know about it because we also are one of them, because everyone can be involved in share market trading. So it is important to know about what are the rights of shareholders. So today, again, welcome you all to Corporate Governance, business BUS 4C22, University of Calicut. Myself, Dr. Jacob, Director of Naipunya Business School. The syllabus module 2, part 2A, talks about agent-principal relationship, shareholders and corporate governance, investors' problem and protection, legal framework of corporate governance, Indian Companies Act, accounting standards, SEBI Act, Securities Contract Act, Clause 49 of the listing rules. Now, first thing that we would be trying to understand is agent-principal relationship. Very often, it's very you would hear this particular word called as agent and principal in a share market. Now, what is a who is an agent? An agent is basically one of the members of the management board, or in other words, CEO, employed by a principal shareholders that includes actually the promoters as well as the minority and majority shareholders. Carry out a task on their behalf. Now, agency refers to the relationship between a principal, that is a shareholder, which includes promoters or even investors or even minority and majority shareholders and their agent CEO. So these are the two words that you need to understand. Agent is a person who is employed by a shareholder to act on their behalf, and this particular type of relationship is called as the agency. Agency costs are incurred by the principals. That means, you know, that whatever cost that are incurred by the agent is held, is will be incurred by the principals. By accepting to undertake a principal task on their behalf, an agent becomes accountable to the principal by whom they are employed. So the CEO. CEO is basically a post which is appointed by the investors, the shareholders, the promoters. So they invest money on a CEO to see that, you know, the organization is taken in the right track by the CEO or the CFO. Right? That is called as the agent-principal relationship. Now we look at what are the problems of investors. Okay, investors, when I mean investors, and like it is also called as the principals. What are the problems means in the, investors means principal, or it can be called as shareholders, majority shareholders, minority shareholders, promoters. All these people are investors. Anybody who invests in a company shares is normally called as an investor or a principal. According to Fernando, when an investor invests his hard-earned money in the securities of an organization, he does so with certain expectations of performance, the corporate benefits that may accrue to him. For example, he may benefit actually in terms of profit. The profit can be actually in terms of money or in terms of other expectations also, value. So many reasons, you know, that you may invest in an organization. There are various types of investors, investors in equity or shares, large institutional investors, financial institutions and banks, foreign investors who come and invest from outside, investors in debentures, people who invest only in debentures, small investors or deposit holders in the form of maybe a bond. They are all investors. The general grievance of investors have against companies can be listed as under 1. Furnishing inadequate information or making misrepresentation in prospectus, application form, advertisement and rights offer documents. Wrong information. Maybe wrong information may pertain to the wrong people in the board, maybe wrong names in the board, or maybe giving wrong information about the balance sheet of a company. And other grievances can be like delay or non-receipt of refund orders, allotment letters, share, debenture, certificate, bond, delay in issuing all these things. Delay non-receipt of share certificate, debenture certificates after transfer. Delay non-receipt of share certificate, bonds, debenture after subdivision or consolidation. Delay non-receipt of letter of offer of rights issue, especially after IPO. Delay non-receipt of bonus shares, right shares, not receiving, neither money also is not given back. Delay non-receipt of notices for meetings, annual reports. Delay non-receipt of interest warrants and dividend warrants on time. Fixing unduly high premium on shares. Obtaining undue benefits by company insiders. Insiders may sometimes get more shares or maybe sell off shares without the knowledge of other investors. Delay in or default in payment of interest and repayment of deposits, especially in bonds or in debentures. They are all investors. Now, agent-principal relationship, investment problem and protection. Now, research studies confirm that an essential feature of good governance is having a strong investor protection. So that is the reason why we should have good corporate governance. One of the major responsibilities in implementation of the principle of corporate governance is strengthening investor rights. I mean, investors can be anybody, minority, majority investor, promoters, or anybody can be an investor. This can be done through investor awareness program conducted by different organizations, especially NGOs, Chamber of Commerce, Chartered Accountant, Indian Company Secretaries, or Institute of Cost Work, SEBI, Stock Exchange, everyone. In order to afford adequate protection to investors, provisions have been made in different regulatory mechanisms also, like Indian Companies Act, Securities and Contract Act, Consumer Protection Act, Depositories Act. How do you resolve actually the problems of agency? One, meetings between directors and key institutional investors. If you are a big institution, big investor. Voting rights at AGM in support of or against resolutions. Voting rights for every shareholder. Need for corporate governance. And if the market mechanism and shareholder activities are not enough to monitor the company, then some form of regulation is needed. In order to afford adequate protection to investors, provisions have been incorporated in different legislations like the Companies Act of 1956, which is updated in 2013, Securities Contract Regulation Act 1956, Consumer Protection Act of 1986, Depositories Act of 1996, and SEBI Act of 1992. And these are all the regulatory frameworks which a company has to adhere if they are to produce actually good corporate governance. Now, what are the legal frameworks of corporate governance? It extends beyond the corporate law, and it shows that that they are transparent as far as dealings are concerned. There is no hidden agenda as far as corporate governance is concerned, and whatever things that the company does is basically for improving the share value or for maximizing long-term shareholder value. In India, legal and regulatory framework of corporate governance is contained in the Companies Act of 2013, then SEBI Act, and under which Clause 49 also is, which is now revised, especially for as a listing agreement of stock exchanges. And every company which is listed in stock exchange has to adhere to Clause 49, which is a revised version right now available. The other legal framework that we would find is that, acceptance of deposit is covered in Section 58 of the Indian Companies Act, where no company shall invite any public deposit without issuing any advertisement in concordance with the companies. That is the reason why you would find that it is advertised in TV, especially when IPOs are there. It is advertised on television. Misstatements in prospectus, if the company does, it can be dealt through Section 6663 with criminal liability for misstatement in prospectus issued by a company. Especially in the case of Sahara scam, it has happened, where SEBI went and challenged that. Non-payment of dividend, section 205, requires a company which has declared a dividend for any financial year to deposit the amount of such dividend within 5 days from the date of declaration of such dividend. Failure to send financial statements, profit and loss account or balance sheet. Section 219 provides for the right of a member for copies of balance sheets and auditor's report. Section 621 permits the shareholder to proceed against the company and its officers in court of law for offences committed under the Companies Act, including prospectus, abridges that wrong prospectus, allotment of shares, listing transfer of shares, dividend payment, etc., committed by a company under various provisions of the Act. Now we come to something called as accounting standards. A lot of importance has been given to those accounting standards because there are different types of accounting standards also followed by companies. There are international versions as well as GAAP also. However, in India, those accounting standards are dealt with Indian Cost Accounts Association, ICA, or the Association of Chartered Accountants. And they offer actually guidelines on how accounting standards should be there for the company to the government. And this is actually contained in section 129 of the new Companies Act, which provides that, you know, that the accounting should be true and fair and complying with accounting standards notified under the 133 of the new Companies Act. The objective of accountants is to assure that corporate governance should be clear, reducing the information gap between the insiders and outsiders. Insiders, I mean, is the promoters and the board, and the outsiders are the majority and the minority shareholders through the disclosure of right and timely information. Now, the accounting standards stipulates the following. All significant accounting policies adopted in the preparation presentation of financial statements should be disclosed to the shareholders. Disclosure of the significant accounting policy should form part of the financial statements, especially after the year, end of the year, financial statements are there. And during that time, whatever accounting policies are there, it should be disclosed. The significant accounting policy should normally be disclosed at one place. Any change in accounting policies which has material effect should be disclosed in the year of such change. That year, whatever has happened in that year has to be disclosed. In case of a change in accounting policies, financial statements affected by such change should also be disclosed to the extent ascertainable. The SEBI Act of 1992 is the next topic that we'll be discussing about. Now, the SEBI Act was formed actually as a response of the Harshad Mehta scam, which happened in 1992, where the big bull called as Harshad Mehta had actually taken huge loans from different banks and then invested in the stock market, and he was able to do certain insider trading, and based on that he had created a furor in the market. The market crashed, and later, you know, he was arrested and put in jail also. However, based on that, you know, SEBI Act was formed in 1992, and right now it serves the interest of the investors in the securities market. So SEBI has got various provisions as far as of listing agreement, where when there is a violation, you know, say SEBI can take up cases. Similarly, investors can also forward their complaints across to SEBI on stock exchanges or maybe on other issues also as far as companies are concerned. And SEBI has got laid down procedures for registering complaints against various market participants also, like merchant bankers, underwriters, portfolio managers, or even credit rating agencies like CRISIL, or foreign institutional investors, venture capital funds, mutual fund, asset management companies also. Now, SEBI was actually formed as by a parliament directive, and it has come into existence and it's doing a tremendous job as far as securities market is concerned. SEBI also has formed committees also to study in detail about investor securities. And we have two committees also coming after SEBI, which is called as the Birla, Kumaramangalam Birla Committee, as well as the Infosys Narayana Murthy Committee also. Now, SEBI has got a contract act in which it is very clear, you know, that the stock exchanges which are granted recognition by the central government can only function in India.
and there should be a single recognized stock exchange in the whole region in order to have a unitary control. This was based on the Regulations Act, which is enacted in order to prevent undesirable transactions. Now, SEBI also has been very proactive as far as share trading is concerned. For example, even in a minor investor also, if you know, like if he wants to sell shares, you know, he goes through a recognized broker, and settlement takes place on the day itself. It doesn't take place; it doesn't get delayed. So SEBI has brought out a lot of procedures to to actually control the securities market as well as to protect the interest of shareholders as well as promoters also. SEBI, Securities Contract Act of 1956. Says that dealers as well as brokers should have license without which they cannot operate as a trader, stock market trader. Similarly, there are bylaws too, which has been provided by the bylaws have been enacted by the central government also regarding periodical returns of trading as well as privileges to compel any company which is a public listed company to get its securities listed also. Other than that, SEBI has got Clause 49 also, a provision wherein there is a right of shareholders or role of stakeholders, disclosures and transparency as the responsibility of board and other things are being listed. Let us look into some of these Clause 49.1 which a company must adhere. Right of shareholder, it clearly says that the shareholders are the ultimate owners of the company. And the job of the company should be to protect and facilitate the exercise of right of shareholders. That is, voting rights or decision-making rights should be. Similarly, there should be given information regarding the financial statements and as well as change in any of the financial policies or even accounting policies also. Similarly, stakeholders also, a company must take care of stakeholders' right and cooperation between company and stakeholders is essential. Now, here I also would like to clarify on two words, one is shareholder and stakeholder. Shareholder is a person who has shares of the company and stakeholder is a person who has got an association with the company. Now, a stakeholder need not be a shareholder, but a shareholder is essentially a stakeholder. Disclosure and transparency is another thing that SEBI insists on. Companies have to be transparent to stakeholders or shareholders by giving disclosures of all material evidences on a timely basis. Similarly, responsibility of the board also to see that that all the transaction and interest of the investors should be resolved on time and grievances, if any, should be settled on time. Or otherwise, investors can definitely go to SEBI and get clarification. Clause 49 also talks about the composition of the board, where it says that should be an optimum combination of both executive as well as non-executive directors. And it should not be less than 50% should be comprised of non-executive directors, especially where the chairman is an executive director. And if the chairman is a non-executive director, 33% of the board should be comprised of independent directors also. And similarly, at least one woman director should be there. Now, the clause also to be clear, that if it is a non-executive director means he is not a promoter. So the 33% is only required as far as independent directors are concerned. Whereas chairman is an executive director, that means he's a promoter, then 50% of the board should be independent directors. And independent directors also should have knowledge and expertise and skills in relevant areas, especially if they are heading the audit committee, they should have knowledge in accounting and financial management skills. Clause 49 also talks about an independent director shall not be a promoter or relative of the company or its or holding or its subsidiary or associates, and he should not have his relative or his relative should not have any pecuniary interest in the company. He should not hold any post himself, nor his relative should not hold any post of key managerial person or employee in the company in even in the preceding financial year where he is going to be appointed. Similarly, he should not be a firm auditor, company secretary, cost auditor, nothing. No, these type of positions should not have been taken by this person, by this independent director, at least 3 years before or a year before preceding the financial year in which he is going to be appointed. 3 years or 2 years, at least three financial years at least he should not have been there in that particular post. Similarly, other things are the relative and him should not have more than 2% of voting power. Similarly, he should not be a part of this NPO who is a 25% receives from that company or its promoter or director. He should not be a material supplier. He should not be less than 21 years of age. And the term is for two terms of 5 years each. And after that, there should be a gap to be maintained. And regarding audit committees, at least 3 members should be there, 2/3 of which shall be independent directors. And they should be financially literate. And 1% must be an expert in accounting or related financial management. Other provisions of Clause 49 are regarding disclosure and transparency. The company should ensure timely and accurate disclosure of information to its shareholders. Information should be prepared and disclosed in accordance with the prescribed standards and rules, according to the type of rules as far as the SEBI is concerned, SEBI policy is concerned. Details also, SEBI says that there should be a vigil mechanism also in the company website. Board's report, disclosure of remuneration and evaluation criteria should be there in the annual report. Board provisions also, a director can't be a member in more than 10 committees and a chairman of more than 5 committees across all boards of Indian listed companies. Independent directors who resign or are removed are to be replaced with new independent directors within 3 months or immediate next board meeting, whichever is earlier. And related party transactions. Now, related party transactions are basically the transactions which are done to associate companies. In the case of Satyam, there was another company called as Mitas, which was a construction company, and Satyam used to transfer its profits to Mitas. This profits was only inflated profit, and whatever profits that inflated profits were always being transferred to Mitas, which was basically an associate company owned privately held by Satyam, which was being where the CEO was the son of Mr. Ramaring Raju. So the money was being transferred to Mitas. So right now, this regarding related party transactions, it is said that it requires actually prior approval of the audit committee, and it requires actually the shareholders approval also through special resolution, and concerned related parties should abstain from voting on such resolutions also. So related party transactions also are being closely monitored by the investors as well as by the board also and audit committee. I hope you have a fair information regarding investment, investors, promoters, and regarding SEBI also. And apart from that, we have also studied on different clauses as far as SEBI is concerned. Slightly a little bit of complicated, but I would request you to kindly read through that, understand. And if there is any clarification required, you can always revert back to me at Naipunya Business School, or you can write to me at hod@mbanimit.ac.in, which is my email address. You can always contact me over email also. And please read books on corporate governance by A.C. Fernando. Definitely that will help you in preparing well as far as corporate governance is concerned. So thank you very much for being with me and listening to this video. Looking forward to meeting you all for the module 2, part 2A, 2B, sorry. Looking forward to meeting all for module 2, part 2B. And that would be the 5th one in the series. So thank you very much for being with me once again. Thank you.